forget the young people.
Amen. Amen. Praise God for them.
When you go to church and you've got two little girls, that's 8 and 10 or 11, and one 22 years old, and then one lady in her 50s, and everybody else over 60, 65, yeah. It's different.
Yeah, sir.
We never need to take anything for granted.
Amen, amen, brother.
So I say thank you. I'm glad that we're here. And you pray for us. Like I said, I mean, I like helping people. I think that's the way that, I think that's what we ought to do.
Amen.
So you pray for me and I pray for you. And we just thank the Lord for you. If you have your Bibles tonight, and stand with us, please. And we'll try to hurry along. You know, my worst critic has become my biggest supporter.
Isn't that good?
Lord, I need likes to hear me preach now.
Praise the Lord.
The book of Joshua, chapter 24, I want to read verses 14, 15, and 16. Joshua's got to be an old man now. He's just about ready to leave here. And this is what he said. Now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. Folks, we all, that's what we need to be doing.
Man.
And put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. There's still only one way.
Amen.
Amen.
There's one God. There's not many gods.
Amen.
But there's one God, and that's the true and almighty Jehovah God.
Yes.
Amen.
And if it seems evil unto you to serve the Lord, notice, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served and were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You want to be happy?
Yes, sir.
Serve the Lord.
Amen.
Yes, sir, brother.
Amen.
And the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. Now then, skip over through the book of Judges. To the book of Ruth, chapter 1. And I want to point out one verse here, the last verse in the book of Judges, and notice what it says. In those days there was no king in Israel, every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Sound like today to me, don't you? And then verses 1 and 2 of Ruth, chapter 1. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. And the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons was Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. Lord, it's me again, your servant, Father. And I thank you, Lord, tonight, Father, for being back home tonight, Lord. I thank you, Father, for this place. I thank you for this church. I thank you for Brother Mike and all the people here, Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord. We love you. We pray tonight, oh God, that you'd help us, God, a little while tonight, Lord, to deliver our heart, our soul, and everything, Father, that we study to these people that we love. In Christ's name we ask. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Thank you. May be seated. Choose you this day whom you will serve. They tell me there's a point along the Continental Divide, high up in the Rocky Mountains in the state of Colorado, at which waters of a small stream separate. And it wouldn't matter if the water went to the right or to the left, and that's where it separates. But this water, one goes one direction and one goes the other direction. One of them, if you put a drop of water in it and it would go west. It would go down to the Colorado River, empty into the Gulf of California, and into the Pacific Ocean. You put a drop of water also, and it goes to the left, to the other direction. It empties into the Mississippi River, the Gulf of Mexico, and the Atlantic Ocean. Two different directions,
yes.
Completely. But there's one small turning point that determines the outlook or the outcome. Many choices in life are like that.
Amen.
Sure, now.
Since choices often result in eternal consequences.
Yes, sir.
Our choices must be in line with God's principles and His Word.
Amen.
Choices must be in the line with God. Whether it's an individual or a church body, anytime our choices are made contrary to God's principles and His Word, we go wrong.
Sure. Amen.
And that will be terrible. Choices. Make choices. Number one, we need to make choices which value relationships over our rights. You know, there's a big thing today. I want my rights. Let me tell you, we don't always have to have our own way.
Amen.
Yep.
Our relationship with one another. We need that. Make choices which values godliness over greed. Now, we're living in a greedy world today.
Amen.
Godliness, I believe it says, with contentment is great gain.
Amen.
So we need to make choices where we value godliness over greed. And we need to make choices which value fellowship with God over the approval of the world. Now, a lot of times we want the approval. Now, I love for people to say, I enjoy that. I appreciate you. But let me tell you, folks, we need to please God above all things.
Amen.
God.
Yes.
So our choices, we need to make choices which value fellowship with God over the approval of the world. We need to make choices which value God's eternal promise over immediate pleasure.
Amen.
You know, a lot of people just live in the moment. But we need to seek to please God above all things.
Amen, brother.
Folks, just a little bit of church on Sunday morning won't do the job. Let me tell you.
Amen.
I guess you've probably caught on now preaching on choices and their circumstances or their consequences. You know, as I was thinking of this, on this, you know, that's something every one of us can relate to.
Sure.
Because every one of us makes many choices every day of our lives.
Sure we do.
And I said everyone, I mean everybody.
Amen.
The preacher,
yes.
The deacons, lay people, male,
Amen, brother.
We all are tempted to do wrong.
Amen.
To cut corners. To let our guard down. Maybe tell a little white lie. A little white lie is all that.
Yeah.
This is what James 1:14 says. Every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. I might ask this question. I'll ask it to myself. What's my problem? What's your problem? We must resist and choose to do the right thing. As I said, we make choices day after day, month after month, year after year. And folks, I'm telling you what, that's what gets us in problems.
Yes, sir. Amen, brother.
Amen.
When we resist, when we do the right thing, when we resist to do the right thing, our character is strengthened and our purity is protected. James 4:17 says, resist the devil and he will flee from you.
Hallelujah.
There was an old lady years ago out at Platte College. She's dead and gone now. Her name is Nancy Russell. She used to say the song, "Shoot old Satan in the back with the gospel gun." Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Praise the Lord. She'd say, "I'm saved and I know I am." So we need to make wise choices to strengthen the body of Christ. I'm not in this alone. You're not in it alone.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Folks, this is a joint effort.
Yes, sir. Amen.
In God's place, there should not be no. I know you've got to have leadership and you've got to have things. I believe things need to be in order. But let me tell you what. We must strengthen the body of Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
Build up, not tear down.
Amen.
When sin's involved, you gotta deal with that in mind. You got to. But folks, we and these young people here, they're at the beginning of their life.
Amen.
Folks, we need to be their example.
Amen.
We need to be their team. I'm gonna tell you a little story here. Has anybody ever heard the name A.C. Green? Okay. A.C. Green was a basketball player who played college basketball at Oregon State University 1981-1985. He was a first-round draft pick by Los Angeles Lakers, played in the NBA from 1985 to 2001, and he is known almost as well for his commitment to remain morally pure as he was known for his skills as a player. He was known as the Iron Man of basketball. You might say,